بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين اللهم علمنا ما ينفعنا وانفعنا بما علمتنا وزدنا علما. We begin by thanking and praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and we beseech him to shower Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam with compliments and salutations and praise and mercy. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to teach us that which benefits us and to allow us to benefit from what he has taught us. We completed last time the chapter of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's dealings ma'al aghniya, with the rich and wealthy, after we had talked about how the Prophet ﷺ dealt with al-masakeen wal-fuqara, people that were poor and had different financial constraints and troubles. So we begin a new chapter today, which is how the Prophet ﷺ interacted with and dealt with dhawil hay'at, people that were of positions of authority, that had some status in society. By now, we have gone through so many different chapters and examples, and we see that the Prophet ﷺ exemplifies the highest level of character with all of those that he interacted with. And the Prophet ﷺ يُعْطِي كُلَّ ذِي حَقٍ حَقَّهُ. The Prophet gives each person their due right, as he ﷺ instructed us to do. أَعْطِي كُلَّ ذِي حَقٍ حَقَّهُ. Give every entity its due right. Actually, this comes in one of the wasaya, one of the advices of the companion Abu Darda. The companion Abu Darda, he said to another companion, إِنَّ لِبَدَنِكَ عَلَيْكَ حَقَّ وَإِنَّ لِأَهْلِكَ عَلَيْكَ حَقَّ وَإِنَّ لِرَبِّكَ عَلَيْكَ حَقَّ فَأَعْطِي كُلَّ ذِي حَقٍ حَقَّ. So this was taken back to the Prophet ﷺ, and Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam confirmed it. Your body has rights upon you, your family has rights upon you, and your Lord Allah has rights upon you. So give every entity its due right. Fulfill the rights to those that are deserving of them. The Prophet ﷺ said in a hadith, أَنْزِلُ النَّاسَ مَنَازِلَهُمْ. A very short hadith, but a profound hadith. I remember one time, one of my teachers, he gave a whole Jumu'ah khutbah on this hadith. أَنْزِلُ النَّاسَ مَنَازِلَهُمْ. The Prophet ﷺ says, put people in their appropriate positions. If a person has status, they shouldn't be humiliated. And if a person is an average person, they shouldn't be exalted and raised to a status, or anyone, they shouldn't be raised to a status more than what they deserve. So if someone did something wrong and they deserve to be punished or scolded, for example, then that should be done in a just amount. You can go overboard. Also, if a person is to be praised or complimented, that should be proportionate. We shouldn't go overboard. And we notice a lot of times, many problems arise due to individuals either being put on a pedestal higher than what they deserve, or being criticized more than what they deserve. And both of the two extremes lead to major problems and misunderstanding and confusion. أَنْزِلُ النَّاسَ مَنَازِلَهُمْ. Put people in their appropriate place. عائشة رضي الله تعالى عنها, she says, أَمَرَنَا رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهِ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَمْ أَنْ نَزِّلَ النَّاسَ مَنَازِلَهُمْ. And this is recorded in Sahih Muslim. She says, the Prophet ﷺ commanded us to give people their due right and put them in the appropriate status that they are deserving. فكان النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يحفظ لهم مكانتهم ووجاهتهم في قومهم. The first thing we notice, number one, The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would preserve for people their status, preserve their status for them, and preserve their standing and the reputation that they had amongst their own people. So we see an example for that is how the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam dealt with Abu Sufyan. Abu Sufyan, who for the majority of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's time as a prophet and messenger, he was an enemy to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he was a leader of expeditions to fight the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the Muslim community, and even at some point to completely eradicate the Muslim community and wipe them off the face of the earth in the expedition of Al-Ahzab, of Al-Khandaq. Abu Sufyan was the main leader of that campaign, if you will. فَكَانَ أَبُو سُفْيَانَ مِنْ كُبَرَاءِ قُرَيْشِ. He was of the most respected and highest of status in the people of Quraysh. ثُمَّ صَارَ سَيِّدُهَا بَعْدَ ذَهَابِ رُؤَسَائِهَا. He was already someone respected and honored. And then once many of the chieftains of Quraysh died and were killed in the Battle of Badr, Abu Sufyan became the Sayyid. He became the leader of the qawm, of the people of Quraysh. In the Battle of Uhud, he was the one in charge of the Quraysh army. فَلَمَّا أَسْلَمَ جَعَلَ النَّبِيُّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ لَهُ ذِكْرًا عِنْدَ فَتْحِ مَكَّةِ. When Abu Sufyan eventually became Muslim, which he did, which in and of itself is amazing, by the way, that after all of these years of animosity and fighting and literally trying to get the Prophet ﷺ killed and the Muslim community wiped out, eventually this very person ends up becoming Muslim. Just in the fact that Abu Sufyan became Muslim, that's already amazing as it is. And what's amazing after that is how the Prophet ﷺ honored and respected him after he became Muslim. Can you believe that? Somebody fights you. So the Prophet ﷺ is in Mecca 13 years. Then he's in Mecca 8 years before Fath Mecca. What's 13 plus 8? I'm not good with math. What's 13 plus 8? Huh? 21? You sure? Positive? 21 years of animosity. More than 2 decades of animosity and hatred and fighting and trying to kill you. What would you do to that person? So Abu Sufyan becomes Muslim. Look at this hadith. فَعَنِ ابْنِ عَبَّاسٍ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنْهُمَا أَنَّ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ عَامَ الْفَتْحِ جَاءَهُ الْعَبَّاسُ بْنُ عَبْدِ الْمُطَّلِبِ بِأَبِي سُفْيَانَ بْنِ حَرْبٍ فَأَسْلَمْ. Ibn Abbas, Allah be pleased with him and his father, he says the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in the year of al-fath, in the year of the conquest, the opening of Mecca, Al-Abbas, his father, Ibn Abbas is saying what his dad did. He said, Al-Abbas, he brought Abu Sufyan ibn Harb. Abu Sufyan, that was his name, Abu Sufyan ibn Harb. He brought him to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and he became Muslim. Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashhadu anna Muhammadan Rasulullah. He accepted Islam. فَقَالَ لَهُ الْعَبَّاسِ. So Al-Abbas, who's the intermediate, he's the one that brought Abu Sufyan. Come on. You need to take this next step. Al-Abbas says to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ إِنَّ أَبَا سُفْيَانَ رَجُلٌ يُحِبُّ الْفَخْرِ فَلَوْ جَعَلْتَ لَهُ شَيْئًا. He said, O Messenger of Allah, Abu Sufyan is a man who likes to have something to brag about. This is his personality. He is someone who likes to have something special, a special characteristic about him. Perhaps you can grant him something to appease him, and especially the fact that he has now become Muslim. And it's not just for Abu Sufyan, but it's also for the effect that Abu Sufyan can have on the community and his society. فَقَالَ لَهُ النَّبِيُّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ. So the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, نَعَمْ, I will in fact do so. مَنْ دَخَلَ دَارَ أَبِي سُفْيَانَ فَهُوَ آمِنْ وَمَنْ أَغْلَقَ عَلَيْهِ بَابَهُ فَهُوَ آمِنْ. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, in this hadith which is recorded in Abu Dawood, and the scholar said it is sound, anyone who enters into the house of Abu Sufyan is safe, will not be harmed, will not be fought. Actually, another narration recorded in the book of Sahih Muslim, the Prophet ﷺ stood up on the mountain of Safa, on a Safa, which is not much of a mountain now, but it's where we make sa'i between a Safa and Marwa. So the Prophet ﷺ stood on top of Safa and made an announcement for everyone to hear. And he said, "من دخل دار أبي سفيان فهو آمن ومن ألقى السلاح فهو آمن ومن أغلق بابه فهو آمن." The Prophet ﷺ entered into Mecca with a huge convoy of Sahaba, of Muslims from all different tribes in the Arabian Peninsula. And they entered in, and there was clearly not going to be any battle or fight. And so the Prophet ﷺ made this announcement that we are not going to look for people to fight. We are not here to pick a fight or to find people to kill. That's not what we're here for. We are here to bring this place back to its origin, which is the deen of Ibrahim, which is Tawheed. So the Prophet said, whoever goes inside the house of Abu Sufyan, he is safe. And whoever lays down their weapons, they are safe. And whoever goes inside their own home and closes their door, they're safe. Even if they want to fight, but you go inside your house and close the door, we're not going to come looking for you to bring you out. But look at the first part. Ash-shahid, the point of reference here, من دخل دار أبي سفيان فهو آمن. Out of, the Prophet could have said, if you go inside your home, you're safe. And he did say that, right? But then he added an extra clause. Whoever goes into the house of Abu Sufyan, he is safe. What do we get from that? We get that the Prophet ﷺ, this is praise for Abu Sufyan. Well, what's so special about Abu Sufyan and his house that if I go inside there, I'm safe? It gives him that position, that status, which he had with his qawm before he was Muslim, before the conquest of Mecca. وقال النووي وفيه تأليف لأبي سفيان وإظهار لشرفه. Imam Nawawi commented on this. He said, from this there is softening the heart of Abu Sufyan. The Prophet ﷺ أعطى كل ذي حق حقا. He dealt with different people based on their situation. You can't paint all people with the same brush. So this is someone the Prophet ﷺ knew. You give him something, you're going to soften him. So he dealt with him in this way. Other people, you give them something, they're going to step all over you. So you got to be tough with them. And some people, the Prophet ﷺ was tough with, because that was appropriate for their personality and their standing. So the Prophet ﷺ, in his ta'amul, in his dealings, is nuanced. He is not hypocritical, but he is nuanced. Some people require a little bit more expression of strength, and some people require an expression of gentleness to get the appropriate response. تأليف لأبي سفيان وإظهار لشرفه. And also showing everyone else that this is a person of honor, this is a person of status. طيب ولما قام سعد بن معاذ سيد الخزرج رضي الله عنه ليحكم في بني قريظة أمرهم صلى الله عليه وسلم أن يقوموا إليه إكراما له. عن أبي سعيد الخدري رضي الله عنه قال نزل أهل قريظة على حكم سعد بن معاذ فأرسل رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم إلى سعد فأتاه على حمار فلما دنا قريبا من المسجد قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم للأنصار قوموا إلى سيدكم أو خيركم فأنزلوا. فقعد عند النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم. قال ابن حجر رحمه الله فيه إكرام أهل الفضل. سعد ابن معاذ, who was one of the special Sahaba of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, and he was سيد الأنصار, سيد الخزرج. The Ansar, the community of the Sahaba in Medina, they largely comprised of two main tribes, although there were others as well. But the two main families were Al-Aws and Al-Khazraj. And Sa'd ibn Mu'adh was Sayyid Al-Khazraj. He was the leader figure, if you will, of Al-Khazraj. Now, there were certain tribes that were Jewish tribes Amongst them was Bani Qurayza. Bani Qurayza. And even before Islam, Al-Khazraj and Sa'd ibn Mu'adh had an agreement with Bani Qurayza. And they were on good terms. They had certain agreements, business agreements, territorial agreements, peace treaties, etc. After Islam, those agreements were maintained. And that relationship was maintained. During the Battle of Al-Khandaq, the Battle of Al-Ahzab, in which a lot of different factions united against the Muslims, one of the factions that was part of the attacking army against the Prophet ﷺ and the believers was Bani Qurayza, even though they had a peace treaty. Now, when you have a peace treaty and you violate it, what's that called? An act of war? Treason. What government takes treason lightly? None. So, after the Battle of Al-Khandaq, when the situation was investigated and it was seen that Bani Qurayza was in fact guilty of treason, the Prophet ﷺ did not carry out any punishment or dictate any punishment upon them. Can you believe that? Treason. The Prophet ﷺ told them, "You choose an arbitrator between us." Amazing. Imagine if, well, I'm not going to give any metaphors. I was going to go there, but you guys get the point, right? So Bani Qurayza, they said, "We choose Sa'd ibn Mu'adh. We choose Sa'd ibn Mu'adh to be our arbitrator between us and you, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam." Why? That's indicative of the good relationship that they had with Sa'd ibn Mu'adh. The good relationship that they had, to the extent that they knew they did a big boo-boo, and they knew they're in trouble, but yet they say, "We want Sa'd ibn Mu'adh to be the judge." That's how good of a relationship they had with each other. So when Sa'd ibn Mu'adh came and he was injured in the Battle of Al-Khandaq, he was injured. Actually, he was the sixth of six to die from the Battle of Al-Ahzab. Five Sahaba died during the course of the battle, and they were buried there in the place of the battle. So if you go to Medina and you go to a place called Masjid Al-Khandaq, or nowadays they refer to as Sab' al-Masajid, right? The seven mosques. There's some history behind that name. There's a big white wall. And if you don't know it, you don't know. Unless you go close, there's a small little placard. But there are five Sahaba that are buried there. And they are the five Sahaba died in the Battle of Al-Khandaq, during the course of the battle. The sixth was Sa'd ibn Mu'adh. He was injured in the battle, and he made dua to Allah. When he heard that Bani Qurayza was guilty of treason, he made dua to Allah. He said, "Oh Allah, please don't take my soul until I can see justice being served to Bani Qurayza." Subhanallah. Lo and behold, he gets summoned. "You are summoned to be an arbitrator between Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the Muslims, and Bani Qurayza." Allahu Akbar. That's the answer of his dua. And so he came, and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, "You guys chose. You're happy with him as your judge?" They said, "We're happy as him being the judge, the arbitrator." Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, "Me too, I'm happy." Bani Qurayza said, "You have committed an act of treason. The punishment of treason is that your menfolk are to be executed." That was his decision. Thereafter, he passed away from the injuries that he sustained in the Battle of Al-Khandaq, and he was buried in Al-Baqir. And the Prophet ﷺ said, "Ihtazza arshul Rahman," the throne of the Most Merciful shook at the death of Sa'd ibn Mu'adh, and 70,000 min al-Malaika, 70,000 angels followed his janazah to Al-Baqir. And he was Sayyidul Ansar, he was Sayyidul Khazraj, one of the chiefs of Al-Khazraj. Tayyib. Abu Sa'id al-Khudri narrates, he says, once it was determined that there's going to be this arbitration with Bani Qurayza, the Prophet ﷺ said, "Go call Sa'd ibn Mu'adh, have him come." So when he came riding on his donkey. فَأَتَى عَلَى حِمَارٍ. He came riding on his donkey. So when he came close to the masjid, before he got down, the Prophet ﷺ told the Sahaba, قُومُوا إِلَى سَيِّدِكُمْ. Stand up for your leader. قُومُوا إِلَى أَوْ إِلَى خَيْرِكُمْ. Stand up for one of the best amongst you. Ibn Hajar says this is ikram, this is honoring people of virtue. وهذا القيام ليس من القيام المنهي عنه وذلك لأن القيام على ثلاثة أقسام. What's interesting is we find another hadith where the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam forbids us from standing up for the sake of honoring someone. Like, for example, what we are required to do in a courtroom, right? When a judge walks in, what do you have to do? All stand. You ever been in a courtroom? Inshallah, you don't have to be in a courtroom. All rise, right? And what's that rising for? Are you going to go give salam to the judge? Hey, how you doing today? Good morning, nice to see you. Hey, nice coat you got there. Is that what you're going to do? Well, no, you'll be arrested. Don't try that at home. You just wait for them. As soon as the judge sits down, then you can all sit down. Same thing in a king's court. Or any person that is honored like that, they walk in, you got to stand up. So the Prophet ﷺ actually criticized this behavior. He criticized this behavior. So how there seems to be some contradiction here. That we find a narration where the Prophet criticizes this, and then we find another narration where he says, stand up for Sa'd, out of respect. The ulama said standing up for someone is of three types. Three different types of standing up for someone else. Number one, al-qiyamu ila al-rajuli wa huwa min as-sunnati. إذا كان الرجل الذي قمت إليه أهلا لذلك مثل ما لو دخل إنسان له فضل في علمه أو دينه أو ماله ثم قمت لتتلقاه فهذا من السنة ومنه حديث قوموا إلى سيدكم ولأن هذا من الإكرام لذوي الفضل وإكرام ذوي الفضل من محاسن الأعمال والآداب. The first type is القيام إلى. We use the word إلى. إلى refers is the preposition that refers towards someone, standing up towards them, which is to greet them or to welcome them. And this is done if they're a person of value and honor, like for example if they have ilm, or if they're a person that has authority over you, like for example someone you dearly love or you honor, like for example a parent. Your parent walks in, you can stand up to greet your parent. Or the Prophet ﷺ, in the case of a child, when his daughter Fatima came in, he stood up to greet Fatima and he had her sit in his seat. Right? So this is honoring someone who deserves that honor to greet them. That's number one. And this is permissible. And the proof for this is the Prophet ﷺ saying to the Sahaba, stand up for Sa'd ibn Mu'adh. قُومُوا إِلَى سَيِّدِكُمْ. And this is from good adab and good behavior. The second type, القيام على الرجل. القيام على الرجل وهذا منهي عنه. نهى النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم عن ذلك وقال لأصحابه لما صلوا قياما وهو جالس إن كدتم آنفا لتفعلون فعل فارس والروم قومون على ملوكهم وهم قعود فلا تفعلوا. The second is القيام على. To stand up in front of or upon. And this is in the case when the person of authority is sitting down and everyone must stand in front of them. So you'll see sometimes certain individuals, as part of them being honored, they come and sit down and everyone is standing. And you can't sit. So this actually happened when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam prayed sitting down. In one occasion, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam led salah as imam and he was sitting down. And all of the sahaba stood up. And the Prophet disliked that. And he said, this reminds me of the worship of the Persians and the Romans. That their muluk, their kings, are sitting in their throne and everyone in their court is standing. So they said, don't do that. If the imam is sitting down, you sit down. So from that, actually, we have a legal ruling, which is if the imam prays sitting down due to a need, the ma'mumin, the people, pray sitting down as well. If the imam comes in, he has a leg injury, and he can't stand up, and he prays salah sitting down, everyone prays sitting down. Isn't that interesting? إِنَّمَا جُعِلَ الْإِمَامُ لِيُؤْتَمَّ بِهِ The imam was made the imam to be followed. So this is the type of standing that is prohibited. We're happy to have children in the masjid, alhamdulillah. We're okay with that. May Allah bless them and make them of the ulama and of Ahlul Masjid. Sometimes we might get a little bit uncomfortable. It's okay. It's okay to be uncomfortable. No problem. He's uncomfortable too. That's why he's crying. الثالث القيام للرجل. Then we have القيام لي, to stand up for someone. وصورتي أن يدخل رجل علينا فنقوم له تكريما فهذا لا بأس به لكن الأولى تركه لأن من هدي رسول صلى الله عليه وسلم أنه كان يكره أن يقوم أصحابه له ولهذا كان الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم يدخل ولا يقومون له وهو أشرف البشر صلى الله عليه وسلم وكان يجلس حيث ينتهي به المجلس. The third type is to stand up specifically when someone enters or walks in because they're making an entrance, standing up for the entrance. And you stand up for that specific person. And this is permissible, but some of the ulama say it is disliked. Why? Because the Prophet ﷺ didn't like for others to do that to him. So when the Prophet would enter a gathering and the Sahaba would stand up, he didn't like that. So he told them, don't stand up when I walk in. I will sit down wherever the gathering has extended to. يَجْلِسُ حَيْثُ يَنْتَهِي بِهِ الْمَجْلِسِ Where the gathering is, you know, people are sitting, lined up or something. Wherever the end of the gathering is, the Prophet comes and sits there. He doesn't come and cross over everyone to get in the middle of the group, right? So the ulama said, because the Prophet ﷺ disliked others doing that to him, then we say it's disliked, but it's not impermissible. It's not impermissible. There is another way of explaining this, which is, as one of my teachers said, when someone walks in, enters the room, do you stand up for them or not? They said it's based on the situation. Whichever of the two has less takalluf. You guys know what takalluf is? We talked about it so much here. Takalluf is when you, how would you translate it? Formality? Is that what it means in Urdu? Well, a formality can be a takalluf, but not every takalluf is a formality. How about that? Kallafa is when you deem something obligatory upon a person. So it becomes something I have to do. It becomes burdensome. Takalluf is when you do something and it's burdensome. It becomes difficult. You were going to say something? Takleef. What does that mean? I like that. Discomfort. So he said, whichever of the two has less takalluf. Sometimes it's very easy to stand up. Someone comes in, bismillah, you just get up, and it's easier to greet them. Maybe they're a very tall person, for example. Or maybe they're someone with a cane, or they can't maneuver to greet you. So it's less takalluf to stand up and greet them. Sometimes if you stand up, you're making a bigger scene. Like someone comes and everything falls over, and then the cup falls, and then it spills, and everything is a big mess. Why? Oh, because he had to get up to give this person salam. Yeah, stay sitting down. Salimu, that's it. So you assess the situation. Someone walks in. Should I get up or not? Whichever of the two has less takalluf. Yes. We like questions. Okay. Ahlan wa sahlan. Kakusi. No, that's Bosnian, not Albanian. Yeah, sorry. Apologize. Whenever someone is like, I guess you call an older person, an adult. Okay. Whenever someone walks in, you know, everybody sits at the couch. We don't get up out of our seat and like move toward them, but everyone stands up where they were seated. Like, for example, I just stand up like this. Mm-hmm. And then we wait for them to go one by one and just so I
Yes.
So this falls under this third category. which is to greet them, and they're going through the line, basically. Yeah. So this falls under this category, which is that some of the ulama said it is disliked because the Prophet disliked it for himself, but it's not impermissible. But we can make it good. Absolutely. And we like things that are respectful. The Prophet ﷺ said, إِنَّمَا بُعِثْتُ لِأُتَمِّمَ مَكَارِمَ الْأَخْلَاقِ. The Prophet said, I was sent to perfect and complete good manners, meaning good manners already existed. And the Prophet did not come to wipe away that which was good. But if there was something that was theologically or ethically not sound, then the Prophet ﷺ replaced it for us with something better. So if something is part of a culture and it is of respect and adab and it doesn't contradict anything in our religion, we have no problem preserving it. So that's fine. Especially if we're talking, now you said something extra, which is that this is an elderly person or someone older than us. They wouldn't get up, right? Because they're older than you. They're like the uncles or the menfolk.
Yeah.
Right. Well, you're an adult too, but a lesser adult. Yeah. Yeah. So definitely the Prophet ﷺ said, لَيْسَ مِنَّا مَنْ لَمْ يُوَقِّرْ صَغِيرَنَا وَيَحْتَرِمْ كَبِيرَنَا. The Prophet said, أو كما قال عليه الصلاة والسلام, he's not from amongst us, the one who does not show love and mercy to our young and honor and respect to our elderly.
I agree with that, but I mean, I'm not
good. Please don't.
I can't. You know what I mean?
So this is permissible.
Yeah, out of respect, I just go along.
Yeah. This example that you gave us is permissible, inshallah. Wallahu a'lam. Yes, sir.
I was told by my father every time a lady enters the room or a place where you are,
yeah,
you get a sign of respect.
Any lady?
Well,
some cultures may say that's flirtatious.
No, you just get, I make people uncomfortable because it's a force of habit. I go to a presentation, when a client enters the room, if there's a lady, I get up.
MashaAllah. Yeah. Jazakallah khair. So this is something out of respect. If it's causing discomfort, then it should be avoided.
Just for the first time.
Yeah. And so we don't have anything in the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ that is specific to a gender, but rather it is for a person of respect or nobility. So for example, I'll give you guys a real example. One of my friends who did not go through the schooling system here, when he came to go to university, college, the first day of class, the professor walked in and he stood up. And everyone was like, what are you doing? And he stayed standing. And he's just standing there. The whole classroom is like, what is this weirdo doing? And so then the professor, she noticed, and she's like, yes, you need something? And he was like, no, nothing. She said, have a seat. So he sat down. So then he realized this is not normal. So then he said, you know, in my country where I went to school my whole life, when the teacher walks in, we stand up, you know, out of respect because we honor the teacher. This is something. And she was amazed. And she said, wow, I wish my students gave me that kind of respect. Right? So there's nuance. We cannot say that it's impermissible, nor do we say do it every time, but we should be careful and nuanced. If we are giving status to someone more than what they are deserving, that's problematic. But when it comes to respecting and honoring people, we have no problem with that. وَكَانَ يَحْرِصُ عَلَى دَعْوَتِهِمْ إِلَى اللَّهِ تَعَالَى وَيَطْمَعُ فِي إِسْلَامِ كُبَرَاءِ الْقَوْمِ وَوُجَهَائِهِمْ رَغْبَةً فِي إِسْلَامِ مَنْ وَرَائِهِمْ وَلِذَلِكَ كَانَ يُوَلِّيهِمْ عِنَايَةً خَاصَّةً فِي الدَّعْوَةِ. The Prophet ﷺ also focused his attention on these individuals, people of status and authority. Why? Because of the impact, the ripple effect that they will have on their community, on their sphere of influence in terms of da'wah, in terms of representing Islam and inviting other people to Islam. وَمِنْ ذَلِكَ انشغاله بدعوة الوليد بن المغيرة وهو من عظماء قريش وكبرائهم طمعا في إسلامه وهو الذي انشغل النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم بدعوته لما جاءه ابن أم مكتوم فأعرض رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم عن ابن أم مكتوم وأقبل عليه. An example of this is the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم being very occupied and giving his attention to الوليد بن المغيرة. Al-Walid ibn al-Mughira was one of the nobles of Quraysh. Someone of wealth, of authority, of respect, who was honored. And the Prophet ﷺ was giving him khas da'wah, special da'wah, conversation and time. That he really wanted this person to have Islam. Why? Because of the influence that they will have upon others. Al-Walid ibn al-Mughira becomes Muslim, whoa, that's going to have a big impact in the community of Quraysh. And he is the one that the Prophet ﷺ was giving da'wah to when Ibn Ummi Maktoum, Abdullah ibn Ummi Maktoum, approached him, who was blind, and the Prophet ﷺ turned away from him. He was bothered by that distraction, he turned away from him, and he focused all of his attention on Al-Walid ibn al-Mughira. So Allah revealed, عَبَسَ وَتَوَلَّى أَن جَاءَهُ الْأَعْمَى. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed the verses of Surah Abasa, that, oh, you frowned and you turned away when the blind man came to you. وَمَا يُدْرِيكَ لَعَلَّهُ يَزَّكَّى. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala criticized the choice of the Prophet ﷺ in this event, in this circumstance. And Aisha taqalat, Aisha narrates, أنزل عبس وتولى في ابن أم مكتوم الأعمى أتى رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم فجعل يقول يا رسول الله أرشدني أرشدني. Aisha says this verse was revealed after the event of Abdullah ibn Umm Maktoum. He came to the Prophet ﷺ. He said, oh, Messenger of Allah, guide me, guide me, guide me. And the Prophet was in the middle of his conversation with Al-Walid ibn al-Mughira. And it was a critical conversation. Notice that Allah, the Prophet ﷺ, did not criticize the fact that Rasulullah is giving attention to Al-Walid ibn al-Mughira. But the Prophet, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, wants Rasulullah ﷺ to make a better choice with his reaction to Ibn Ummi Maktoum. Because what Rasulullah ﷺ was doing was giving honor to this man of honor, giving him special da'wah. That's the point that is related to this aspect of his character. وعند رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم رجل من عظماء المشركين فجعل رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يعرض عنه ويقبل على الآخر ويقول أترى بما أقول بأسا فيقول لا ففي هذا أنزل. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم is talking to Al-Walid ibn al-Mughira and he's saying, everything I've told you, do you see anything wrong with that? Is there anything wrong with the message I'm telling you? And he was saying, no, there's nothing wrong with it. But he was too arrogant to accept. ومما يدل على حرصه على هداية الناس وخاصة الزعماء منهم قوله اللهم أعز الإسلام بأحب هذين الرجلين إليك بأبي جهل أو بعمر ابن الخطاب قال وكان أحبهما إليه عمر. We also find the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم making dua and saying, oh Allah, grant izzah, grant dignity and honor to the community of this deen of Islam through one of two people, through one of the two that is more beloved to you, Amr ibn Hisham or Umar ibn al-Khattab. Abu Jahl, which was his nickname, his name was Amr ibn Hisham, and Umar ibn al-Khattab. These were two people in the community of Quraysh that had strength and honor and dignity. Nobody messed with them in Mecca. But they were fiercely opposed to Islam and to the Prophet ﷺ. Fiercely. Abu Jahl, we know. Amr ibn Hisham, we know the stories. Umar ibn Khattab, fiercely opposed to Islam. One of the Sahaba said, Himar al-Khattab, the donkey of his father, is more likely to become Muslim than Umar ibn Khattab. When someone said, it seems Umar ibn Khattab is coming close to Islam, he said, his daddy's donkey is more likely to become Muslim than him. That's how far he was in his animosity towards the Prophet ﷺ, towards the Muslim community. So the Prophet made dua. Why is he making dua? Allahumma a'izza al-Islam. Oh Allah, grant izzah, grant dignity to the community, to Islam, to the community of Muslims, through one of these two people becoming Muslim. We all see it happen. When a famous person becomes Muslim, it's all over the headlines. And it has a major ripple effect. Because people of notoriety, people of influence, their choices and their decisions are always observed. Someone who's famous and has influence amongst people, every little thing they do, people want to copy it. Why do you think they put Tiger Woods on a cereal box? What does he have anything to do with cereal? Well, he is very successful in whatever he does. And he is liked by people. So you put him on a cereal box, people are more likely to buy that cereal. Now they're using it for business purposes. The Prophet ﷺ is making dua so people will get hidayah. No one's making money off of someone becoming Muslim. It's for their own good and their own benefit. وَكَانَ أَحَبُّهُمَا إِلَيْهِ عُمَرٍ. And the narrator here says, and the more beloved of the two to the Prophet ﷺ was Umar. The Prophet liked Umar ibn Khattab more than he liked Amr ibn Hisham. And Umar ibn Khattab ended up the one out of the two to become Muslim. In another narration, which is recorded in Ibn Hibban, and some of the ulama said it is authentic, the Prophet said, Allahumma a'izz al-Islam bi Umar ibn al-Khattab khassa. Oh Allah, grant izzah to Islam through Umar ibn al-Khattab specifically. And when Umar ibn al-Khattab became Muslim, he brought izzah to the Muslim community, even though they were so small in number. Nobody messed with Umar. Nobody messed with him. When Hamza ibn Abd al-Muttalib, radiallahu anhu, the cousin of the Prophet, the uncle of the Prophet ﷺ, became Muslim, he brought izzah to the Muslim community. He defended the Muslims. So sometimes an individual can bring izzah to the Muslim community through their accepting of Islam. وَمِنْ ذَلِكَ دَعْوَتِهِ لِلطُّفَيْلِ بْنُ عَمْرٍ وَهُوَ مِنْ سَادَةِ قَوْمِهِ. Also, the Prophet ﷺ made dua for an individual named At-Tufayl ibn Amr, who was a Sayyid, who was someone who was noble amongst his people, Ad-Dawsi. And Muhammad ibn Ishaq قال, كان At-Tufayl ibn Amr Ad-Dawsi يحدث أنه قدم مكة ورسول صلى الله عليه وسلم بها فمشى إليه رجال من قريش وكان At-Tufayl رجلا شريفا شاعرا لبيبا فقالوا له يا طفيل إنك قدمت بلادنا وهذا الرجل الذي بين أظهرنا قد أعضل بنا وقد فرق جماعتنا وشتت أمرنا وإنما قوله كالسحر يفرق بين الرجل وبين أبيه وبين الرجل وبين أخيه وبين الرجل وبين زوجته وإنا نخشى عليك وعلى قومك ما قد دخل علينا فلا تكلمنا ولا تسمعن منه شيئا قال فوالله ما زالوا حتى أجمعت ألا أسمع منه شيئا ولا أكلمه حتى حشوت في أذني حين غدوت إلى المسجد. He says here in this narration that At-Tufayl ibn Amr, who was from Daws, when he came to Mecca, he was honored and he was a person of eloquence and poetry. When he entered into Mecca, Quraysh swarmed around him and they told him, listen, we have a major problem in our city now. They said, listen, this guy has separated between an individual and their father, and an individual and their brother, and an individual and their wife. Why? Because they become Muslim. And their family refuses to become Muslim, so they end up parting ways. And he says, his speech is like sihr. It is like sorcery. So don't talk to him and don't listen to anything he says. Tufayl ibn Amr says, I swear by Allah, they kept on insisting to me that I stay away from this man until I said there is no way I'm going to listen to a single word that he says, and I took cloth and I stuffed my ears with it. I don't even want to hear him by accident. He stuffed his ears with cloth so he doesn't even hear the sound of the Prophet ﷺ. فغدوت إلى المسجد فإذا رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم قائم يصلي عند الكعبة فقمت منه قريبا فأبى الله إلا أن يسمعني بعض قوله. He says, so eventually I went to the masjid, which is al-Kaaba, which was a place of respect even amongst the mushrikun. And he says the Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم was there making salah by himself, making salah in front of the Kaaba. He says, so Allah planned for me to hear something from his mouth. فَسَمِعْتُ كَلَامًا حَسَنًا فَقُلْتُ فِي نَفْسِي وَاللَّهِ إِنِّي لَرَجُلٌ لَبِيبٌ شَاعِرٌ مَا يَخْفَى عَلَيَّ الْحَسَنُ مِنَ الْقَبِيحِ فما يمنعني أن أسمع من هذا الرجل ما يقول؟ فإن كان الذي يأتي به حسنا قبلته وإن كان قبيحا تركته. He said, I heard something from him and it sounded nice. So I said to myself, man, what a silly guy you're being. You are an intelligent guy. You can discern good from evil. So what's stopping you from listening to the guy? See what he has to say. How can you take those other people's word for it? Listen to him yourself. And you're smart. If he's saying something good, welcome. And if he's saying something evil, I'll leave him be. فَمَكَثْتُ حَتَّى انصَرَفَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صلى الله عليه وسلم إِلَى بَيْتِهِ فَاتَّبَعْتُهُ حَتَّى إِذَا دَخَلَ بَيْتَهُ دَخَلْتُ عَلَيْهِ فَقُلْتُ يَا مُحَمَّدْ إِنَّ قَوْمَكَ قَالُوا لِي كَذَا وَكَذَا فَوَاللَّهِ مَا بَرِحُوا يُخَوِّفُونَنِي أَمْرَكَ حَتَّى سَدَدْتُ أُذُنِي بكرسف لئلا اسمع قولك ثم ابى الله الا ان يسمعني قولك فسمعته قولا حسنا فاعرض علي امرك. He says, I stayed there observing and listening to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam praying until he finished praying, and then he left the masjid and he went home, and I followed him all the way home until he went inside his house. So I opened the door and I went inside his house behind him, and I said, oh Muhammad, your people insisted upon me and they would not leave me alone until I was convinced that I should not listen to you, until I stuffed my ears with something. And you know what? I heard you praying back there and I heard you say something nice and I would like to hear. So go ahead, tell me, share with me what you have to say. فعرض علي رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم الإسلام وتلا علي القرآن فلا والله ما سمعت قولا قط أحسن منه ولا أمرا أعدل منه فأسلمت وشهدت شهادة الحق وقلت يا نبي الله إني امرؤ مطاع في قومي وأنا راجع إليهم وداعيهم إلى الإسلام فادعوا الله أن يجعل لي آية تكون لي عونا عليهم فيما أدعوهم إليه فقال اللهم اجعل له آية. So the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم explained to me Islam. And he recited to me Quran. And it was only a matter of short time until I accepted Islam. And I made the testimony of Shahada, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashhadu anna Muhammadan Rasulullah. And then I told the Prophet ﷺ, I am obeyed amongst my people. Ya rajulun muta'a, my people listen to me. And I'm going back to my folks now. And I will call them to Islam, to that which you have presented me with. So make dua to Allah to give me a sign, to give me an edge, an ability to convince them that Islam is the truth so that they would accept Islam. So the Prophet ﷺ said, Allahumma ij'al lahu ayah, O Allah, grant him a sign. فخرجت إلى قومي حتى إذا كنت بثنية. He says, so I went to my people until I reached an elevated place before where they were living. وقع نور بين عيني مثل المصباح فقلت اللهم في غير وجهي إني أخشى أن يظن أنها مثلة وقعت في وجهي لفراق دينهم فتحول فوقع في رأسي سوطي فجعل الحاضر يتراءون ذلك النور في سوطي كالقنديل المعلق وأنا أهبط إليهم من الثنية حتى جئتهم فأصبحت فيهم فلما نزلت أتاني أبي وكان شيخا كبيرا فقلت إليك عني يا أبتي فلست منك ولست مني. He said, I reached this elevated place before where my people were living. And he said, I found right in front of my eyes, between my eyes, this bright light. And so I made dua to Allah, oh Allah, take it away from my face. I am concerned that they will say, there's something wrong with you, that you have been afflicted by this in your face because you left our deen. And so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala removed it from my face and put it somewhere else. And I approached my people with this light and it got everyone's attention. And so everyone came to me. And the first person that came close to me was my father. And so I said to my father, oh my father, hold on. We are no longer the same as we were before. I have accepted this deen. أَسْلَمْتُ وَتَبَعْتُ دِينَ مُحَمَّدٍ. I have become Muslim and I followed the deen of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. قال يا أي بني فديني دينك. He said, oh my son, your deen is my deen, your religion is my religion. If this is what you think is the truth, I'm with you. And so his father accepted Islam. And it was one like that with his mother and his relatives until his entire family entered Islam. ثم دعوت دوسا إلى الإسلام فأبطأوا علي. Then I called my whole tribe, Dawes, the whole tribe, to Islam, but they were very slow in responding to me. ثم جئت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم بمكة فقلت له يا نبي الله إنه قد غلبني على دوس الزنا فادع الله عليهم فقال اللهم اهدي دوسا ارجع إلى قومك فادعهم وارفق بهم. He said, I came back to the Prophet ﷺ and I told him, oh messenger of Allah, they're not responding to me. And they are still stuck in their old ways and their sins and their habits. So the Prophet ﷺ made dua. He said, oh Allah, guide Dawes. And then he told me, go back to your people and be gentle with them. And be gentle with them. قال فلم أزل بأرض دوس أدعوهم إلى الإسلام حتى هاجر الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم إلى المدينة ومضى بدر وأحد والخندق ثم قدمت على رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم بمن أسلم معي من قومي ورسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم بخيبر حتى نزلت المدينة بسبعين أو ثمانين بيتا من دوس ثم لحقنا برسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم بخيبر فأسهم لنا مع المسلمين. He said, until after the hijra and after Badr and after Uhud and after Al-Khandaq, meaning after the fifth year after the Prophet made hijra, and I'm still making da'wah to my people until the expedition of Khaybar, and then I came to the Prophet ﷺ with 70 or 80 households from my people, all of them accepted Islam and we joined the Prophet ﷺ. So Rasulullah ﷺ made dua for him, and he was a person of influence amongst his people. And the Prophet instructed him to give da'wah to his people. So here we see the Prophet ﷺ respected those that were people of respect and honored those that were people of honor and dignity. Put people in their place. Give everyone their due right, even if they are a person of influence, even outside of the Islamic community, give them their due respect and make du'a for them that Allah guides them, because the khayr, the benefit that can come from them, will have a lasting effect. We will end here for tonight, inshallah, and we will continue next week, inshallah ta'ala. And I see that there are some questions, so we will address some questions, inshallah, but after a brief break, inshallah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala beautify us with the character of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Jazakum Allah khairan, wallahu a'lam, wa salamu alaykum.